didn't think about it before, but lately, having kids and all that, I think about why I did what I did in my books. And I think it's all to do with, like, not just leaving home, but not being able to go back, and that feeling of leaving one continent, coming to another, being in the new world, trying to feel like how other people felt before when they did something similar. So I think they had to do it had to do a lot with what I was experiencing. Even, like, think the books I did about animals was always like lonely animal, if it was rainbow rhinoceros or the whale, which doesn't fit anywhere. So I was feeling like I'm trying to find my way to fit in, which was really hard, because would I have, like, worked for the bank, I would see people every day. But if you're an illustrator, you sit home most of the time. And on the top of it, I had very sort of time-consuming style, which I invented in order to be very special, but it completely killed any free time or any weekends. I think I'm sort of very lucky that I even found my wife. When I came to do these illustrations, I was virtually working day and night, and came up with this style of little dots, and that really took lots of time. And then, unfortunately, because people would see it in the New York Times, they would say, can you do a book like that? So I did all the first books, I don't know, first 5, 6 years were made of little dots. But I was extremely lucky, because I thought that, I think that helps us sometimes in life, that we have this inflated idea about ourselves, that I thought, oh, I can do children's books, children just will love my ideas. But I really, growing up outside of the United States, I knew nothing about pizza, I knew nothing about cartoons, I knew nothing about peanut butter and jellies. You know, like, I didn't have any sort of connection with the childhood, baseball. But I grew up with, like, Three Musketeers or Monte Cristo. And yet I was lucky, I just think it was sheer luck, that even with that sort of distorted view of what's appealing to children, I was able to, in the beginning, to do my books, because everything changed since I have my own children. Because at first, when they were born, I thought I have to leave some legacy or some message to them. So I did a book about Prague for Madeleine called Three Golden Keys, because I thought, well, she has to know where, she will be wondering why her father was like who he was, so I do a book about that. And then the same thing when my son was being expected, I did a book about Galileo, because I thought I have to do a book about somebody who was very special and show him that sometimes life can get difficult, like with Galileo, when he has to sort of answer all the questions of the cardinals. But then when the kids grew up a little bit, I realized they are not really interested in it at all. And since then, I'm trying to sort of observe them and see what they like. So that would go for all the little books I did for my son, which were about fire trucks he loved, and bulldozers and ships and dinosaurs, and for little girls like Ballerina, or the whole series, I hope, of Madlenka, when the little girl who lives on the block in the big city meets all these people who are from different countries and different cultures. Because when I grew up in Prague, people really wouldn't speak to each other, because they were just simply afraid to, just the political regime and climate was terrible. So, and now comes another problem, because when I did Madlenka, when I did Ballerina, they were little, so I could observe them and I didn't have to ask them for permission or anything. And now, of course, they moved on, because my time work takes too long. So Madeleine is now 9 and I have 6-year-old Madlenka, and I can see that I cannot keep on going with them, because all of a sudden, I'm not going to do a book about Madlenka listening to Britney Spears or something. So in the way, I will have to let him go and stay with some sort of dream of 6 years or something. He was sent to make a film about this construction of the road to Tibet, and he was just him and the cameraman. So we had 2 25-year-old guys, and they had 35mm. I mean, it was incredible, because they had these heavy, heavy cameras and crates full of film. But I didn't know any of that. I was little, I knew my father left, and he told my mother he would be back for Christmas. Because when I was little, I thought he left for many, many years. And then looking at his diaries, he left for 19 months. But in that time, I was like 4, and by the time he came back, because it spent 2 Christmases, and I went to school. So lots of things changed, and it was never the same. And he came back, and he couldn't really talk about what he's seen, because he was supposed to talk about, like, working class in China. So that whole thing about Tibetan Buddhism and Dalai Lama and all that was, like, not appreciated. So only person he could talk to was me, and also he wanted to reestablish our sort of relationship. So he would tell me about this country called Tibet, and I thought it's fairy tale. And he told me about this guy all in gold who was Dalai Lama, who was 19 then. So then it was amazing when I did the book, I actually presented the first copy of the book to Dalai Lama, who I met and gave him scarf. He gave to my father 45 years before that when he was 19. So it, in a way it was a full circle because the whole family then lived from the stories my father was telling about Tibet. He was the first person from Prague who went to Tibet, so he became like celebrity of person who was in Tibet. I sort of have it in my head, and then I would do it probably. Probably I would like to do pictures first, and then I have to come up with the text. So then I'm blessed because I have this editor who understands me or doesn't want to make me angry, so she's very gentle, and then I come up with some text which is necessary to explain what I meant. But I try to keep the text minimal because in the way how I speak or express myself, it's more in the pictures, maybe because I came from somewhere else. And the text, I'd always cringe when kids would say, well, you are the author, you are the writer. I don't consider myself being writer at all, or author. And also I'm trying to desperately show to kids that it's not a big deal what I'm doing. I even had a show in Prague when I purposely left all the pictures without any mount, so they would see that I mess up, that the sides are colors which are dripping or something. And I put sort of, I mean, I didn't, but the people in the exhibit put the steps so the kids could come and look at it. Because I remember when I was little and I've seen some paintings which look absolutely like exquisite, I thought I can never do this. So I would like to get somehow message over that, yes, you can do that. And yes, you can have a good idea even if you are 12. And if you put it on the paper and make some doodles, maybe somebody will look at it. I realized it all depends. Didn't want to put him under pressure because my impression in New York schools was that, compared with where I grew up, was that everybody came to the kindergarten and said, well, our son will be a lawyer and our son will be a... Everybody had to, like, nobody said my son will be a carpenter. I want my son to be happy. I just want him to read with love and be happy and do it right. So now he's reading every night wonderfully, but he's getting very slowly into it. And definitely the parents who would want him to be a lawyer at Harvard, they would say, oh, you are too slow, you 7 and are you reading so slowly? But I think it's like walking. He will read just fine, and it's more important that he will really love books and read them. So I don't know how helpful I am, but I definitely don't do it with my own books because I'm sort of embarrassed to say, you have to read my own book. So maybe they don't even know that much about my books as some other kids do, but I think it's better that way. I said at school they shouldn't say that I do books, that they should say I'm a trumpet player. Or...
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.